We got one more lightning talk from Srae, ka-Lillian, who will be talking about procedural phonology, generating name generators, another level of procedurality. So, yes.
All awesome. Right. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. Right. Awesome. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. It's a tremendous honor to get to talk about one of my all-time favorite subjects with one of my all-time favorite communities. My name is Srae, ka-Lillian, and I'm going to talk about random name generators and how we can use phonology to generate not only names, but name generators themselves. My goals as your guide today are to introduce fundamental concepts clearly and concisely, to open a window into a world you might not have known existed, and to highlight what's cool about a thing I love. As a disclaimer, I'm not an expert on phonology. I should be doing my slides. I'm not an expert. I've never formally studied linguistics. I'm just a nerd who wanted to make a random naming language generator, which I've been working on and off for the past couple of years. And everything I know about phonology, I've learned through that experience. So my perspective on the subject might be a little informal. And so bear in mind, this is just one account among many. Sometimes in works of fantasy fiction, you have worlds with multiple nations or cultures, and sometimes they speak different languages. When we give different characters or places names that are identifiable as belonging to the same language, ties them to a parent culture, with, much as in real life, and suggests a distinction between that culture and other cultures speaking different languages. So this can be a cool, interesting, or meaningful avenue of identity within the world, or it can just be a cool detail. If you're doing procgen work and you're generating arbitrarily many worlds with arbitrarily many cultures, and you want the names used in those cultures to reflect distinct cultural identities, you need a way to supply arbitrarily many languages to draw names from. And generating random name generators is a great way to supply yourself with a never-ending supply of naming languages. So with this purpose in mind, we can name a couple of goals for our generators and the languages they represent. First, their output should be varied. A name generator that only generates one name won't do the job, no matter how pretty the one name is, nor will a generator that produces 1,000 names that are technically distinct but experientially very similar. It's okay to have a couple similar names. You know, English speakers survive having John, Jen, Jean, Jane, June, Jan, all in the rotation. But if these were all the names we had, it would get confusing. So on average, names want to be mostly distinct from most other names. At the same time, the names name generator produces should be cohesive. Names within a language have the sense of sharing something in common, which isn't necessarily evident in every pair of names, but across larger number of names, patterns are visible of sounds and shapes that recur. So this, in this list of Latin masculine given names, you can immediately see a handful of common sounds keep coming up, as well as a suffix that is happens to be universal in this set of names. At the same time, the overall output of a name generator should also be distinctive, which is to say that the patterns of sound and structure that are consistent within the language should be different from the patterns of sound and structure in other languages at hand. So when you compare these Japanese masculine given names to the Latin ones from earlier, you can see there are different sounds in use, different consonant clusters, different suffixes, etc. A language that's both internally cohesive and externally distinctive is likely to have a strong sense of identity, which is essential if you have more than one language in your world. And then on a functional level, we want the names each generator produces to feel intentionally formed. What this means precisely is a matter of interpretation, but we at least want to keep names that read as generation errors to a minimum. And we should also hope that our names are generally pronounceable, whether that pronunciation, the pronunciation people come to is correct or not. If you can't come to any, if you can't find any way to pronounce a name that's in front of you, it'll have a harder time sticking in memory and risks degenerating into noise and being forgotten. Phonology is a branch of linguistics concerned with speech sounds and their relationships to each other, specifically as they occur within a language. Phonology is concerned with questions like, how do we break a language's speech up into different sounds? What sequences of sounds are allowed and which are forbidden? How do sounds, different sounds influence each other in proximity? And how do a language's sounds change over time? Phonology is not particularly concerned with the production and perception of speech sounds as physical phenomena. This is the concern of phonetics, which is a distinct field that often is relevant to phonology, not a ton of use to us right now. Phonology helps us make name generators in a couple different ways. First, it helps us identify the different components that come together to make up the sound system of a language. And then second, it highlights the patterns that shape each of those components individually. So once we identify these components, we can describe the basic shape of a procedure for generating a language, which I'll do next. And then we'll take a closer look at each of these components and see what phonology can tell us about generating them individually. So our basic strategy is built around three components. To start, naming language has to know what sounds or phonemes are available and how prominent each one is. And this knowledge is called our phonemic inventory. Then it needs rules to combine those phonemes together to form syllables, and that knowledge is called phonotactics. With your phonemic inventory and phonotactics decided, we can then generate one or more syllables at runtime and then combine those to make multisyllabic names. We might also use some additional techniques to smooth out syllable boundaries when combining syllables, and some of those techniques come into play again if we have more complex names with multiple roots in them or suffixes attached, and all of that stuff falls under the category of morphology. Deciding a language's phonemic inventory is the first step in generating a language, but before we can even do that, we have to decide what languages are available to go in sounds what sounds are available to go in languages at all. This is both a practical question and an aesthetic one. There are more than 2,000 different sounds by some estimates across all of the world's languages, and the Roman alphabet we use in English has only 26 letters for us to work with. So for the sake of keeping our workload manageable and our outputs readable, there's a wisdom in keeping our master inventory small and mostly limiting it to sounds folks in our audience have some prior intuitions about how to pronounce already. For me, this means not using a lot of accent marks, which help distinguish sounds, but also I think risk coming off as visual noise to a lot of English speakers not used to interpreting them. And then to keep things from feeling too English or too European in general, I like to use a handful of un-English sounds with interesting alphabetic representations, which I've highlighted in this slide. These all represent relatively common sounds worldwide, but are still pronounced reasonably close to the letters I use to spell them, so they can add some flavor without causing too much confusion. With a master inventory decided, we can then decide which of these sounds should be available in the specific language we're generating. There's a lot of data online, a couple different databases that can describe the prevalence of each sound across languages as individual sounds, and we can use that to estimate the chance of each sound appearing independently in the generator. There are more sophisticated ways of doing this might produce more cohesive results, but in practice, the results are a little bit subtle. So in my view, it's perfectly valid just to select phonemes independently and not worry about how they relate to each other. Phonotactics is a big question dealing with where different sounds are allowed to occur structurally and in relationship to each other. The highest level question here is about syllable structure, which has a huge impact on the overall shape of words. The traditional model of the syllable consists of an optional consonant portion called the onset, followed by a mandatory vowel portion called the nucleus, and then another optional consonant portion called the coda. Virtually all languages allow syllables to have onsets, but not all languages allow codas, and languages also differ on other factors, like whether onsets or codas can include multiple consonants, or whether onsets are optional or mandatory, or whether codas only occur in the middle of words, or at the end of words, or both. With syllable structure established, we can ask questions about how frequently each of the sounds in our language occurs and in what contexts. Sometimes consonants appear more often in one place than another. For instance, the H sound in English only appears in the onsets of syllables, and I think literally never in the coda, which you can see in the great number of English words beginning with a breathy sound compared to the complete absence of any ending with one. We can also ask questions about how specific sounds operate within the structure of a syllable. And particularly important here are consonant clusters, as most languages are highly restricted in which consonants are allowed to touch and in which contexts. So if we aren't careful, we can wind up with consonant soup. At the same time, an unusual consonant cluster can be really distinctive and evocative, so we might not want to be too prescriptive about what is and isn't allowed. Morphology describes how multiple meaningful elements like roots and suffixes are assembled to create more complex words. We call these units of meaning morphemes, and strictly speaking, it isn't necessary to have multiple morphemes in a name, but seeing elements recurring across different names can help us identify internal structure, which helps tell that there is an intentional order to how names are shaped. When two morphemes are combined to make a more complex word, sometimes sounds change at the boundary between them. This is a really complicated area that we're free to mostly ignore, but we should be aware that it can potentially put two sounds together that our phonotactics has forbidden to touch. In real languages, these meanings can result in some complex changes to one or both sounds, or to even to sounds surrounding them. But I've learned that one of the most common results of these changes is just to delete one of the offending sounds entirely. I used to be really hesitant to doing this, but once I learned how common it was, I wished I'd always known, because you can solve a lot of problems by just deleting them. But no matter how well we answer our phonological questions, we're still going to get some names that don't look quite right. When this happens, we have a couple options. We can try to identify what we don't like about them and change our strategy or add new safeguards to prevent those problems from cropping up in the first place. But we can also try to embrace the weirdness of them. Partly, I think we should be humble when making judgments about what names are sufficiently normal or attractive for our purposes, because the possibility space of language is completely enormous, and our exposure to it is necessarily quite limited, especially for many of us who only speak English. And our exposure to languages outside of English is heavily biased in favor of the handful of European and maybe Asian languages that we have the most incidental contact with. So when we generate a name that looks weird to us, we have the option to ask if that might be something that's normal in another language that we don't have the context for, or that could be normal or could have been normal in a language that existed in the past but no longer does, or that could still exist in a language, or that could exist in a language that doesn't yet exist. Which brings me to my final thought, which is that when we're playing with language, we don't have to feel beholden to simulating the real world in its entirety. This is, at the end of the day, a generative art that has the potential to be creative, speculative, or a fantastical endeavor that celebrates the weird and unreal and potentially real right alongside with the actual real. Fundamentally, generating name generators is an art, at least as much as a science, and art can and should do a lot more than reproduce established rules. And that's all I know. Thanks for coming to my talk, and have a happy Roblox celebration.
Thank you. What a lovely final slide. Excellent. Yeah, no, thank you for that. Yeah, people in chat were definitely engaging and sharing lots of other kind of things it reminded them of. So
I'm thrilled to hear it.
Yeah, it spawned, I think, a lot of conversations. So thank you.
Little or too much time for questions.
I think that we just hit the moment of the end of the block, so you timed it into exactly the lightning talk slot. So thank you for that, and